My current line of research started out of a personal crisis. I finished my PhD just in time for the Latin American debt crisis that caused havoc in all the countries from Mexico to Argentina. I'm from Venezuela. And macroeconomics was just the topic to discuss: how to fix the fiscal, the debt, the banks, and so the exchange rate, the inflation, and so on. The generation of economists that I belong to really succeeded in slaying that dragon and in bringing many countries from basket case to investment grade, from triple digit inflation to single digit inflation. But growth didn't really take off. If you had asked us, would we succeed on the macro as much as was succeeded in many countries, we would have said unlikely. But contingent on that success, we would have said marvelous things would happen, and marvelous things on the growth side did not happen. So that led me to believe that there was a big secret behind what really growth is about that we were completely missing.
The Cathedral of the Holy Cross in Boston, USA was finished in the year 1876 in the Neo-Gothic style. Neo-Gothics was popular in the 1800s because the spirituality and focus on the individual of the Gothic period was attractive during the time of the cold rationality of the Industrial Revolution. Today, the cathedral hosts a broad diversity of congregations: Jesuit Catholics from African Eritrea, German apostolates, traditional Latin Mass, and modern English and Spanish communities. Diversity is not only fascinating, diversity also creates economic wealth. Professor Dr. Ricardo Hausmann of the Kennedy School of Government at Harvard University here in Boston proved that complex and diverse societies experience faster economic growth.
Why are there rich countries and poor countries? Well, when Adam Smith, the father of economics, wrote the book on this question in 1776, the richest country in the world, which was probably the Netherlands, was four times richer than the poorest country in the world. Today, that same gap is about 400 to 1. Why would these differences have expanded so much? Economists have tended to look at output as coming from several substances, like capital, education, health, urbanization, and so on. It's very easy to note that this cannot be the puzzle, the answer to the puzzle of why there are rich countries and poor countries. Ghana today has the same education that France had in the early 1980s, and today Ghana is 20 times poorer than France was back in the early 1980s. So in spite of the fact that Ghana can work with 35 years of more modern technology and the same level of schooling as France, they're generating barely 5% of the income that the French were able to generate back then. Say these same differences we can find all over the place. It's impossible to explain rich countries and poor countries based on the traditional metrics of urbanization, education, health, and so on. Something big is outside of this story. And what I'm going to argue is that that big thing that's outside of the story is know-how, is the knowledge to make things. That is the fundamental substance that makes rich countries and poor countries different. When you look at a rich country and compare it to a poor country, typically, the rich country knows how to do many things and relatively complicated things. And the poor country typically knows how to do few things and relatively simple things. That's an indication that the rich country just has in its society more knowledge than the poor country. Now, that does not mean that the rich country is populated by geniuses and the poor country is populated by imbeciles. Quite the contrary. The problem is that for a society to know something, it doesn't mean that each member of society must know that thing. In fact, we are all limited in our capacity to know. When Harvard was founded in 1636, a college degree lasted 4 years. Today, it still lasts 4 years. How much material can you teach in 4 years? The amount of material you can teach hasn't changed much, but the total amount of material that could possibly be taught in a university has gone up enormously, because now we have physics, chemistry, biology, anthropology, political science, economics, all so much more knowledge to be shared, but we still only have 4 years. So the way societies accumulate more knowledge is not by having more knowledge deposited in each person, but by having different bits of knowledge deposited in different people. And consequently, this division of knowledge allows us to store knowledge in different brains. But then to use that knowledge, we need to bring these brains back together again in some kind of network that we might call a firm or a network of firms. So today, to make an airplane, Boeing, with 165,000 workers, doesn't have enough workers to make the plane. They barely make 15% of the parts that go into making the plane. They require a whole network of suppliers that span the whole world, that have the knowledge to make all the parts and pieces to make the whole plane. By contrast, a subsistence farmer, he pretty much knows everything he needs to know to produce. But he produces with very little knowledge, because he only produces with the knowledge he has in his head. A modern farmer, he uses seeds he doesn't know how to make, he uses fertilizer he doesn't know how to make, he uses a tractor he doesn't know how to make, he uses gasoline he doesn't know how to make. The secret of working with a lot of knowledge is not having a society of geniuses. It is having a society where different people know very different things, and there's the capacity to bring these people together to create value. One of the key things that happens as a society develops is that it acquires different pieces of knowledge that it must put together again. So in some sense, the economy resembles a game of Scrabble, where different players are given different letters, and the economy is about putting letters together to make words. And you immediately realize that if you start the game with very few letters, say just one, you're probably going to make at most one word. But if I give you three letters, you can make more words, maybe four words, and you can make words that are three letters long. If I give you four letters, you can make maybe nine words. If I give you 10 letters, you may make 600 words and longer words. So as you increase the number of letters, you increase the number of words you can write, so it's the diversity of the words you can write, but also the length of the words you can write, the complexity of the words you can write. So this idea that more complex countries, more advanced countries have more letters, they make more words, more diverse production, and longer words, more complex production, can actually be taken to the data. And we can measure how many different things each society has and how complex are the things that they have. And we can estimate implicitly what is the number of letters they have, what is the amount of capabilities they have. And really, it's when you take it to the data, it's very clear that rich countries have more letters than poor countries. They have more productive capabilities than poor countries. And not only that, that the countries that are relatively poor, given the amount of letters that they have, tend to grow faster. While the ones that are too rich for the amount of letters or productive capabilities that they have tend to grow more slowly. So in this chart, we see on the x-axis the amount of productive capabilities, the letters that countries have, and on the y-axis, we see how rich they are. And in general, you see that there's a good relationship between how rich a country is and how many letters it has. However, not all countries are well aligned on the line. Some are below and some are above. The ones that are below are too poor for how much they know, say like India. These are countries that tend to grow fast simply because they already have the knowledge to be richer than they are. But then there are other countries above the line, say like Greece. These are countries that have figured out how to be rich without knowing much. But unfortunately, those situations tend to be not sustainable. And that's one of the reasons why Greece has been doing so poorly lately. So if the puzzle of development is how to get more productive capabilities, more knowledge, more letters, how does one go about it? Well, immediately you see that there's a problem that societies are going to face. There's a chicken and egg problem. You don't want to be a watchmaker in a country that doesn't make watches. But you can't make watches without watchmakers. So how does a society that has never made watches, how do they start making watches? That's a puzzle, because there is a chicken and egg problem that needs to be addressed. We find that this chicken and egg problem limits the possible diversifications that a country can have. It's easy for a country to make a new word if most of the letters are there, and it's missing just a few letters, maybe just one. So that transition, that expansion of diversity is more feasible. In order to capture this idea that there are some diversifications that are easier than others, we've developed this concept of the product space. Product space relates a product to other products that are, if you want, cognitively close. So that if you know how to make product X, it's easier for you to also learn how to make product Y, because there are fewer missing letters in those transitions. So the product space is one way of understanding the cognitive relationship between products, but it's also a way to know where in the product space each country lies. So for example, a country like my own, Venezuela, it will know relatively little beyond oil, while compared to a country like Mexico, or a country like Germany. So that as you look across these countries, the amount of diversity you observe in their production and the complexity of the products that they make changes very dramatically. So the process of development is really the process of getting to learn how to do more things and more complicated things. This is not a learning that is happening at the individual level. This is a learning that is happening at the collective level. A society knows more not because each individual knows more, but because each individual knows different. And putting these different pieces of knowledge together is the secret of more complex production. Today, a modern firm needs people to know about finance, about purchasing, about production, about sales, about legal stuff. And you need these diverse teams to work together to make any single product. How do you promote development at a local level, at the regional level, at the country level? It's essentially by tapping into these bits of know-how. But know-how really resides in brains. It doesn't help that much to read a book about playing music for you to become a good musician. It takes many, many years of practice. Malcolm Gladwell likes to say that it takes 10,000 hours to become really good at something. It takes 10,000 hours to become really good at something, but it takes very few hours to go from one place on Earth to a different place on Earth. So it is much easier to move brains than it is to move knowledge into brains. So the process of putting knowledge into brains is slow relative to the process of moving brains. That is why diversity, complexity, knowledge, economic growth happens much more quickly if you're able to tap into moving brains. So foreign direct investment that brings management in, migration that moves people around, the existence of diasporas that are culturally connected to their mother country and can be a transmission mechanism for knowledge, all of these things end up affecting very significantly the speed at which knowledge moves in space across countries, and even within countries. So if you want to create prosperity, you need to move into more things, new things, more complex things, more interesting things. That will require know-how, and know-how moves through very surprising channels. If you take this view of development and prosperity, that it's really about the accumulation of know-how in society, it leads you to think in very different ways about how to create that prosperity. It's no longer about just having firms get access to capital or improving the quality of schools for everybody teaching the same material. It's not about necessarily working with your own people to make them better, but complementing those people with others that are not present. It means that more of the process of development happens by what is happening to individuals collaborating in society, differentiating in what they are good at, and finding new ways to collaborate. It points you in very different directions, and I hope in very promising and energizing directions. I hope you have enjoyed this short lecture, and I hope that entices you to learn more about it.